Motivation is something that people talk about a lot in the hobby. I thought we'd just speak about how people can find motivation. What are your tricks to stay motivated?
When something comes in and I'm like, I want to paint that, it's because I'm like ravenous to paint.
Can you get any more motivated than describing yourself as ravenous for something?
The more time I have to paint, and like how motivated I am to paint, like don't live on the same plane, if you get what I mean.
People that struggle for motivation, are they people that potentially actually do have a lot of time to paint?
If it's a stressful day or like that, painting is like the best cure to that.
Do you know what? I for so long did not associate painting with relaxing.
I think that is the root cause of why people have these massive piles of grey shame. So what happened with the towel then, Joe?
I've been building the... I got one of the Kill Team boxes. I think we mentioned it on there before.
Yeah.
And I brought it up to you because on last week's one, you were talking about the Night Lords reveal and how, oh, maybe that's just a upgrade spree or whatever. And I think it almost definitely is because that's what the Kill Team boxes have been. And as I have experienced with this Pathfinders one, I've never built like Tau infantry before. They are the fiddliest, like, horrible thing to build. Like,
not enjoying that one, eh, Joe?
Well, they're fully built now.
Is that because you're used to building like bigger models, though?
Yeah, or just like, I guess, like Space Marines and stuff.
But Space Marines, I guess, are like, massive compared to the range when you think about it.
No, but even I think it's not necessarily the size of the model. It's literally like to the point of the tout, like the gun. Isn't even in one part. Like you have to put the scope on it, but it doesn't feel like, you know, like with the intercessor ones where you do that, there's like, it's like a bit of a clunky part. Like you have to slot it in and everything. Like this is literally like, you have to balance it on top of the gun. It's just a scope and you have to balance it on top of the gun and make sure there's no real like.
Good connection point
where you're like, oh, okay, that's clicked in. That's the right bit. So it's a lot of guesswork on that thing. And like the mold lines is like just in the most awkward.
I don't mind building kits that have a lot of parts. I mind it when the parts are really small and it's hard to scrape a mold line on it. That bothers me more than anything.
Some of the parts in that kit are quite tiny though. Like I remember when I done Darkstrider, the mold line on the Dragon Ball Z 9,000 power reader.
Yeah, do you know what I mean?
Like that was pretty intense.
It's like what I would say is the actual mold lines themselves on the kit fairly easy to clean. Like that's fine, especially like on the helmet, they're almost like non-existent. Like they're actually, it's a really good quality kit, but like the amount of tiny little parts and like, just like gluing, making sure they're glued in properly and like look normal and stuff like that. There's just like weird little gaps as well, especially on the gun. Like I say, with the scope on the gun, it doesn't like fit flush into something. Like there's a little gap that's left on one side and you're like, well, have I glued that properly of it? And then I'm looking at the box art and I'm like, okay, no, there's a little gap there as well. Just very weird kit to build, and it was like very stressful experience.
Has it demoralized you to carry on with the project?
No, I'm still, well, it's definitely put me off doing any kind of army, but the kill team will get done.
I don't think the full range of models is like that though. Like, bear in mind, your infantry probably gonna have like 20 infantry.
I don't remember having problem with like the normal pathfinders.
Do you know what it is? I think I kind of said before, whenever I was building Space Marines, like I don't want to put any of the patches, like the pouches on, and like I don't want to do any of the extra little bits. So where I've never done that before, really.
This is the antithesis of that, because you've got a base kit and it comes with an upgrade sprue, which is basically extra bits.
Not only, this is the base kit, which they all have pouches and things on. And I decided before I was doing it that I'm gonna do the pouches, and then on top of that,
you said that so reluctant.
Yeah. I made a decision. I was like, I'm gonna do it, like because I normally wouldn't. Then on top of that, it's one of the kill team ones, so they're all a little bit unique. They have their like little individual bits that you put on them. So I think I've just gone from like 0 to 100. I've been doing like Space Marines with no extra pouches or anything. And then I've gone to Pathfinders.
So in a box ticking exercise of things you don't enjoy about building models, this ticks every single one of those. And you went, you know what, I'm going to do a kill team.
Yeah. I nearly.
Good choice, Joe.
The only way it could have been worse is if I'd done sub-assemblies. which I haven't done.
Did you not do sub-assemblies?
I haven't done sub-assemblies. Luckily, I would say with the kill team things, because they're all a little bit more unique and they have like little few more things going on. A few of them are like open poses anyway. Okay,
that helps.
It's not like they've all got the gun strapped across them kind of thing. So I haven't done sub-assemblies, but I have only used super glue. So if I do need to break anything off, I suppose I can. Yeah, I can give it a little...
Give it a little Hulk.
Yeah. Give it a little nudge. But yeah, obviously I've been ill for a few weeks. I wasn't here last week. I was like pretty much only building. I could not be bothered to paint. So I built that, and that took a lot of willpower, if I'm honest.
What are you going to paint them? What scheme are you going to do?
I think I'm just going to go for the Tau Sept. Like we spoke recently about the Darkstrider box art that I really liked, and I kind of want to go lean towards that. I think, see what I can.
I feel like you don't see a lot of that, really.
No, you don't. Most people go Viola or Farsight Enclave.
Yeah.
So I think I'm going to see how I get on with that. Do that. Built a couple of other things as well. I've had the Gaunt's Ghosts box for forever.
They're really great.
I started building those. Yeah, that. I think I want to do those more as like a proper display thing.
They're really, really
cool. They're such cool models, yeah.
Yeah, they're brilliant.
James, you done any hobbying?
So following the release or the preview of those Night Lords, I started painting a Night Lord. So Sai from CS and myself have done a bit of a skill swap. He had a model that he made that he wanted painted, and he said, if you paint this, I'll make you something. So I was like, okay, cool. He's taken really awesome old school Chaos Terminator Lord, and then re-envisaged it with a new model that he's made. He's kit-bashed and then obviously done loads of sculpting on it, which has been up on our social.
It'll be on the screen now for people watching.
So it's it's been real fun actually. And then in return he made me Astrath. So I've always wanted an Astrath. It's a really, really awesome bit of artwork that I love of Astrath. It's like an upward shot from below, as if like the camera's on the ground looking up at him. It's like just using the axe that he's got, decapitating a Chaos Black Legion Marine. And I just thought it was a really cool pose. So I asked him to make me that. So he made me that, and then I'm gonna paint him the Night Lord. So yeah, so I started on it. He sent me a really cool reference of like it wasn't a Night Lord model, but he loved the purplish bluish tone. I just trying to get that color as close as possible was a bit of a fight. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. Is it getting you geared up to do your Night Lord's kill team?
I'll probably just do his model, I think, after trying to. But the thing is like, I'd probably follow a different reference if I was going to do my own ones. Probably just more along the lines of like Cantor or something like that as like an armor color. But like. It's just that, so I really wanted like this purpley kind of like, I think it's because the OG model is like a purpley blue.
Mm.
So I think he wants that on this reimagination that he's done, which I think is great. But yeah, it took a little bit. I was mixing colors and I was putting in a bit of everything really to get this purple the way it was needing to go. Got there in the end. It was, yeah, only mixed it three times, but anyway, it's all good. Yeah, so it's all good.
So I was ready to put this to bed, the whole base room debate thing. We've been going on and on and on and on and on. But then something strange happened. None other than Darren Latham messaged me just to let me know that he's on Team Coloured Base Room.
Well, no, first of all, say the full message. What was the full message he said? Because you're swaying it a little bit here. You are swaying it a little bit.
Because
he did make a clarification.
It is a little bit skewed.
Daz says, I'm with you, mate. Coloured Room for gaming. Black for display, which is actually right. What I said. So, if you roll back the tape.
Hang on a sec. So
I love that we're all like, right, now hang on a minute.
So of course you proceeded to then message me and tell me. I think there was a really good meme going around. Now a bit of 2x4 normally isn't my weapon of choice.
That was one of the listeners who made that meme, by the way.
That was brilliant. I'm gonna say it's a great meme, absolutely smashing meme. A bit of 2x4 isn't my normal weapon of choice, but in this instance it was suitable enough. But yeah, I had to do a bit of investigation on this. I'm not going to lie. So when you messaged me, I had a little cheeky look.
He was so chuffed of himself, yeah. Joe, when he done this. Like he was like,
I haven't been in office, by the way, for
I don't look.
He came up to me like he'd like cracked the case. He's like, George, another thing. Look at this. Look at the evidence.
So look, okay, I'm very much an analytical, evidence-based kind of person, and
I did a little bit of checking, I've got to be honest. And I think there was, you know, out of 100 or so odd posts, I think there was a much higher...
Over 100 posts?
James just sat there with his magnifying glass going through Daz's Instagram. Yeah.
I've got to say, there was definitely a bass towards a black bass drum, in fact. God.
Well, I don't know what to say to that. I think in general, the case that we've came to, like, I was obviously saying black bass drum, you're saying black bass drum, but I think what he said, where it's like brown for gaming and black for display, that is kind of, I think, because we don't paint anything to game with, but I still think the thing that gets me, I don't want to argue with Darren Latham. But the thing that gets me is the argument for doing the brown bass rim so that it fits in more with a gaming table or whatever.
Well, it's not the table. It's supposed to be like the scene on the bass, which probably is supposed to match the table. So it's like a...
Well, no, we've been through it. We've been through this. They're not on a little mound, are they?
Please do not bring up the cake again.
Joe, imagine a cake.
This isn't... based on what Daz has said, but there's been a few comments about the gaming thing as to how, oh, it's better to have a brown bass room because it blends in with the battlefield and blah, blah, blah. And like, if that's the, I still get to the point of like, if that's the aim, what, you can only play on that battlefield then? If you turn up with your brown bass room and it doesn't match the snow battlefield, are you then completely taken out of it and you can't possibly imagine, it doesn't look exactly the same, I can't do it.
So I'm just going to say, I do like both, okay, 100%. I think both...
He's backpedaling now.
No, hear me out, okay. I understand the point about if you're playing on a gaming table and you want the bass to match in with the ground, I get that totally.
My point that I always made was I wanted it to match the colour of the surface of the bass. Whatever the basing scheme is, the bass rim should reflect the basing scheme.
Is that where the cake came from?
That's where the cake came from.
I think that no matter where you stand on this argument, we can all agree that we've spoken about it way more than
is necessary. I didn't realise how far this was going to go. Let's do some listeners' comments, Joe.
You really did light the flames of fury in people, I think, when you started that one.
Tybeck says, 3 months ago, I would have died on the hill of black bass rims, but now I'm absolutely sold on Steel Legion drab for certain models. I started painting a GSC army in a desert theme and the black bass rims seemed to cut the model off too harshly. Steel Legion rims just make the bases flow better and tie them off. I'm completely on Team George of this one. Sorry it took me so long to leave my black rim cave.
So do you know what? I'm actually going to agree with you on this one.
What is this? From Darren Latham and he's like, he had all his fury of 100 posts and whatever.
Okay, number one, I didn't actually check 100 posts. It was a quick scroll.
But now he's putting an average.
But no, what I would say is that, like, I think you're quite in that situation where the basing colour is so light, as in it's such a high contrast colour, like sand, like tones and things like that. It can look a bit like harsh having a black.
What started all of this was when I'd done my black templars, because the problem was there was just too much black on the model.
Is that how this all started?
That was how this all started.
It wasn't the cake.
No, it wasn't the cake.
No, the cake was the explanation after.
I used to do black rim for like basically everything. And then I started doing the Steel Legion drab for my Sons of Horus just randomly on a fluke, because I was literally matching the box art like fully. And then when I was doing my black Templars, I'd done a black base rim and I was looking at the models and I was like, something doesn't look quite right. I couldn't work out what it was. And I realized that I'd liked the look of them more when I still had them in the sub assemblies before they was pinned to the base.
Yeah, no, it makes sense.
And then I realized it was the base rim.
Yeah. This whole conversation though has 100% just opened up the biggest market gap ever though. Like, what you're saying obviously about it not matching most tables that you play on, it might match that your home
clear base room.
Well, I wasn't even say clear, like
clear bases.
No, you're missing out on the opportunity in a product. You could make like rim covers, but like
James actually just say the word rim covers?
Yeah.
Did that just happen?
It did, yeah. You could literally make a product to cover the rim of the base. To style it to
like
the table.
Like a beer koozie.
Ugh. Well, no, it's like a home and away kit in football. It's like, you know.
So you can match it to whatever gaming table you're...
Yeah, so you go around your mates. Your home battlefield.
I love the idea of rocking up to a tournament, right? You've got a 2,000-point army. Yeah, you're playing a horde army, let's say. You've got like lots of models, and you get put on the snow terrain, and you look down at your army, and you've got your steel legion drab, and you're like, just give me a few minutes, mate. I've just got to put me
my wake it on.
Just got to put my snow rim cover on. And then you're sitting there with all your models going through individually wrapping
the... Just clip on. Just done.
You could do them. Remember those like wristbands where you like slap them on your wrist and they curl up? You could like do a little version of that where you just like slap it on the base and it curls around the base.
Yeah.
Yeah, perfectly.
What is happening?
I've always said I'm about a market gap, and that is definitely one that will.
I think if this conversation doesn't put this base rim conversation to bed,
I hope it does.
People realize how stupid it is.
I hope it does.
Then nothing will. It'll carry on going. However, I will continue to just do black base rims, I think.
Just a quick one. Wanted to let you know that you can get your own miniatures painted by the world-class team here at Siege Studios. We offer a variety of painting levels and services to meet your needs and budget, whether you want a centerpiece character or an entire gaming army. We offer well above the industry standard of quality and experience. You can learn more about our services and get a quote now at siegestudios.co.uk. And just for you podcast listeners, you can get 5% off your first commission with us here at Siege using the code PAINT5. Now back to the show.
So one of the things I asked last week, sort of anecdotally, was I asked what people are doing while they're listening to the podcast.
Yeah.
Tons of comments for this. Turns out, spoiler alert, painting.
Yeah, mostly. I read a lot of the comments. Surprising answer? Probably not.
I don't think so. I think given obviously what we normally talk about and the things that we go into detail, I think it's, I mean, I've had people tell me to listen to it while commuting.
Well, one I bet you probably wouldn't have predicted. Dan Everall says, excellent podcast. I've consumed all of them in the last 10 days, all while working as a dental technician making dentures. It's given me more inspiration and planning insight into different projects.
Oh, so, fair. So if there's loads of false teeth out there with skulls engraved on them.
Yeah, then, he's been practicing his
freehand.
His green stuff.
You get your new veneer and there's like a chaos star.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's sick. I'd be interested to know, like, yeah, the obviously most people are listening to us while painting, but I wonder what like the most like off the wall unique place for someone to listen to us is. That's probably up there for now. While doing dentures.
Yeah. I don't think that's quite what we had in mind when we came up with this podcast, but it's up there. Tezza B says, whenever I listen to this podcast, I'm painting. Currently on, you're like this, James, a squad of Blood Angels Intercessors.
Right choice.
I've taken your advice and I'll be going outside my comfort zone soon, starting with Tyranids and using contrast paints for the first time. No idea on colour schemes. Any clues where to start with this is appreciated.
Well, we actually done a really good episode with about Nids. So there's loads and loads
of quite a few colour
schemes on there. But
that was kind of the whole point of that episode, was we painted like a whole bunch of different schemes.
Yeah. And the thing is like, I think one of the things with Nids is to really break it into a couple of specific components on the model. So the carapace, the flesh, and then like accessory details like claws, eyes, teeth, things like that. And that's, then you can obviously move on to basing, et cetera. But I think choosing two high contrast colors for the scales or for the chitin and also the flesh, I think that's always a good place to start, and gives you a really good, interesting scheme to start off with.
Christopher Harrington says, painting now while listening to you guys. I find I take on your advice if I'm painting at the same time as listening to you all. Makes me focus and slow down a bit. Currently painting an aberrant ghoul king for my terror geist.
Awesome.
Yeah, nice. Okay. That's cool. That's like...
It's a really good bottle.
I was just going to say, based on like the kind of listening to us while painting, and I suppose it does make sense, like, especially the nature of the podcast, generally the topics are about things you can implement like
now.
Right now. Like it's not... A lot of it isn't like... You have to work up to it, or something like that. It's like if you've got a brush in your hand and a model in your hand, you can probably do some of the things that we say. So
yeah,
and give them a go. So that's pretty cool.
Big Cap says, "I love this podcast. It's helped me gain more confidence to just paint more instead of thinking about painting or watching tutorials and doing nothing with the information." That's actually something I mentioned on a previous episode. One of my like big points for improving was stop sitting there procrastinating, watching those videos and actually just do it.
Yeah.
Then he follows up with, recently I've been trying to challenge myself more in between what I normally paint. I typically just paint Space Marines. Currently I'm painting a Screamer Killer in the black and yellow scheme of High Fleet Jormungandr,
yeah, I think it is, yeah.
And trying to use a big brush as much as I can, even with the small details. I'm getting better at controlling the brush and the paint consistency with this side challenge. Very impressed with myself so far.
Well done, yeah. That's awesome.
Nice, yeah, that's nice. A James special, the big brush.
Big brush and the brush and, control.
And brush control, yeah. And
that's, that scheme as well, that yellow and black is, again, exactly what we're saying, tying back to the other thing, high contrast black and then a bright colour.
Yeah. Right. It's like a proper James bingo, that comment.
And dipping out of your comfort zone as well.
Yeah, so, yeah. It's
you,
all
when you when James is in bingo.
Yeah.
And I haven't even dropped one yet.
Yeah. Right, this is a bit of a longer one, but this has multiple points in it and I didn't want to just paraphrase it too much. So,
okay.
Marty Milligan says, I love these podcasts. I always find myself looking forward to the next one. Thank you very much. I've not really had much of a hobby urge in the last lot of months. I try to set aside the length of these podcasts to at least do something hobby related while listening to you guys. That's a really good idea.
That's mega, yeah.
The release of 10th seemed to really kill a lot of my hobby interest. So as I was so hyped about the new edition to start getting back into the game again, but I was disappointed with the game, the direction the game went. While listening to some of your episodes and finding some other content on YouTube, I realized that this is my hobby. I can go back in time to when I loved the game the most, which was second edition, and I can paint my newer models that way and try to build some squads the way that they were back then when I had most enjoyment. So thank you guys for helping provide me with an excuse to get back into things. And then he also says, I cannot recommend Siege enough. A couple of years ago, I had two small Space Wolf commissions done.
Oh, amazing.
Great work.
Awesome. I was going to say, yeah, as soon as you read that name off, I was like, I think that's a past client.
And one last little point there, just to tie it all in. Wonder if you guys would be up for a special Christmas episode.
Oh,
well, there are some thoughts. There are some thoughts.
So there's a lot of layers to this.
Yeah, there's quite a few.
Now that is a cake.
So what was the first kind of thing they touched on? Oh, about like making the hobby your own and
yeah, it's your hobby. You can do it how you want.
100%. I think that's great. Like that is a lot of. I think we touched on it previously with regards to when maybe I was mentioning about like people not liking when Intercessors came out and Primaris and stuff like that. And it's like, it doesn't really affect the things that you liked about it. If you do really like that older stuff, paint that older stuff then.
Well, exactly. I've got like a second edition Ultras Force downstairs in the office on the shelf and it's all Primaris stuff. And it looks mega in the blue, yellow and red. Like you can just paint them there's nothing, just because they're the newer models doesn't mean you have to like paint them in the.
I'm even talking about like if you factually just don't like the new models, or as the comment was saying that like don't like the new game rules and things like that. There's 10 editions of this game now. Like if there's one that you prefer, play that one.
Yeah.
Especially if you like was already playing 9th.
Yeah,
well,
yeah,
exactly.
Still just play 9th. Like, you don't have to go to tournaments and stuff. Like, you can still just play 9th with your friends and stuff.
Like, the Games Workshop police aren't like kicking in your door and like forcing the new edition point. Like, when new Kill Team came out, me and my friends just carried on playing the old one. I've never played the new one.
Yeah.
We still play the old one
it's,
now.
It's weird. I do get the. It's almost disappointment, isn't it? That the thing that you enjoy doing isn't the current thing. So the one that everyone's talking about isn't the thing that you do. If you carry on doing that, I do understand that. But at the end of the day, if the one that you enjoy is the 9th edition or 2nd edition in this case or whatever, whether that comes to painting or gaming, they don't really go anywhere. People are playing Mordheim still. Like people are playing games that haven't been supported for years, let alone new editions.
One of the things is that finding a game can sometimes be a little bit hard, and that's why obviously people stay with the meta of the edition, if that makes sense, which is fine. And I think it's good. Like I think, you know, something new is always good. But at the same time, you're quite right. Like those games, the books are still there. The rules are still there. Like there are things like from old editions that I love. One of the things that's not in 10th edition that is now that there used to be, like I used to love challenges. So I used to love like when you two units would charge into each other and the characters go, well, they can fight and we're just going to square up. But I think you can't do that anymore, which I think narrative-wise is a really interesting thing for gaming. I think it's putting characters again, that you can't do that anymore. I miss that hugely in 10th. Doesn't mean I can't go and pick up 7th or 6th edition and go and play it and do those challenges again, you know? It just doesn't change that.
I like the idea almost of, you know, one of the things that I have this complaint with like video games and stuff.
I'm glad you brought up video games like that because
one of the things I don't like is that they're like always, it's like feels incomplete. Like it can change at any time. Yeah, so the current edition of 40K at any given time, whatever the current edition is, will have updates throughout the year, which is good and bad. It's good because it's needed sometimes.
Yeah, for balance.
But then it's, for me, it's bad because it's like, I like to just be able to have the thing and this is the rules and that's how it's played and that's that. And it's the same with video games, I feel like. Like now they're...
Seasons,
and they're incomplete when they're released. And whereas you used to just be able to like buy a game, it's on the disc and that is the game and you play the game and that's it. So I'd quite actually like the idea of going back to an older edition and knowing that it's complete almost. Like this is, it had as many changes as it can. You can, in hindsight, look at the changes and decide what ones were better and what ones fit how you want to play and whatever. I actually like that almost, rather than it being a constant current evolution kind of thing.
I know exactly what you mean. Like, I mean, I'm not known prolifically for playing video games. I do kind of bash them quite a bit sometimes, but like, I don't mind picking up the old PlayStation and playing Gran Turismo.
He was about to say PlayStation 2, wasn't he?
I was going to say, I played
2 was the next word coming out of his mouth.
I played Gran Turismo. I played Gran Turismo on PlayStation 2 as well.
But, you know, Joe, because they'll call them computer games.
Yeah, computer games.
That's what I call them. Yeah, games.
Yeah. PS2. I mean, you were fond of a... I'm sure you had a GameCube, didn't
Fantasy
you?
Fantasy Star Online. Anyone who knows.
Yeah, you were fantasy fond of a GameCube.
Fantasy Star Online was great.
Long
game.
Before my time.
Yeah.
No.
I never had a GameCube. It wasn't necessarily before my time, but I never had a GameCube.
Yeah. I literally hemorrhaged tens of hours in consoles when I was a kid.
Have you not thought about like the new, there's loads of cool games coming up for 40K now. Like New Space Marine and Vermintide.
It's been delayed. The new Marine game's been delayed. Yeah. So
I am interested in the Space Marine.
Yeah, I didn't play the first one.
Neither did I, but I'm going to do some... I'm up for some co-op story.
100%. I'm telling you this now, like the new Marine game was the first game I was like, whatever console it's on, I'm buying it. Like, because
we
I want to play it.
We should do a co-op.
Do a podcast let's play.
Well, the thing is, it's three player. From what I've heard, it's three player. So it's you can do three players.
Is it
up to four?
Is it up to four?
I thought it was three. Well, we'll get Luton on and he can rate.
Oh my God. If we did a stream or something, where it was all of us playing and Luton was playing and narrated it for us, that'd be incredible. I can't believe all that came from that one comment, by the way. But just to
tail that one off, huge thank you for being a client of the business and the kind words that you say. That's really, really kind. I'd say that it was awesome to paint some Space Wolf models for you. So just a big thanks.
One final comment is from Shahido, who says, I still don't know the definition of heavy metal style. I thought it'd be important to include, actually, because we talk about box art style a lot around here. And I realize if one person's commenting it, I guess we have just sort of assumed that everyone knows what that is.
Yeah.
So James, far away.
Why are we just like...
You're like the heavy metal expert. You've got the masterclass book behind you, James.
Look behind you.
That was... Okay, that was planted.
It's yours, though.
Yeah, it is my book, yeah. It's
planted
true.
By you, I might add. There was a different one behind him before this, Joe, and he snuck that in.
I dressed the set because I thought, look, we're going to talk about motivation, and that, for me, is a bit of motivation. But we'll talk about it. Yes, I planted it, but I didn't realise it was going to be used as shotgun ammunition to against me.
Just explain the stuff.
So first things first, I want to just say this, as George pointed out, that I'm an expert. I am frankly not an expert. Okay.
I don't know if I said it out loud, but in my head, I thought I was going to say you're a fanboy.
I will gladly take the name fanboy. Yeah.
I thought you might be a bit more comfortable calling yourself
that. Well, because since he does so much research on artists like Darren Latham, I'd assume that he's
hundreds
done the
of images.
Again,
yeah.
When I scrolled, it looked like 100 posts went by. Okay. All right. But point being, the box
like
art.
Tibetan monk. I prefer
to think that you counting them and you're like, 32, another black base room. 33, another black base room.
Who am I, Inspector Clouseau? What do you think I'm doing? No, it's not an investigation into it. No.
I thought that was like your tier list of like, who's like a really good inspector?
I don't know who that is.
That's the guy from Pink Panther.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't, yeah.
How do you know that?
How do you know that?
You're still chewing on blooming for freshers. What are you talking about? Yeah, so essentially box art style is how the models are painted on the box. This is an obvious one from Games Workshop. That style has changed over many years, as in like it's in second edition.
Just to clarify quickly, that team is called Eavy Metal.
Yeah.
That's why we say Eavy Metal.
Yeah, whenever you hear, I suppose, yeah, if you're coming at it from someone who's just started painting, they don't necessarily know the terminology and things. If whenever you hear people say Eavy Metal style, the dropping of the H is intended as well. So it's every metal style.
Yeah.
And box art style, they're the same thing.
It's basically the same terminology for the same thing, basically. Yeah. I mean, the team was obviously called the Eavy Metal team. And from that, it's just been called the Eavy Metal style, which then also means box art style, as we mentioned.
So that's the team who paints all of the official artwork on like the box of
for the game, box of for Games Workshop like as well. Cause also now as more brands, become like a little bit more popular and mm-hmm. things like that, other companies' box art style is different.
Yeah,
It specifically references.
It's not a generic
Games Workshop's.
Yeah, box it's not art a generic style. Thing that goes across multiple yeah. brands or manufacturers.
Eavy Metal is Games Workshop specific, but box yeah. art style, I guess, could technically mean anything.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, yeah. And really, the style of painting has kind of evolved quite massively from sort of second edition, whereby it was a lot brighter, as in the colors and things, obviously very vibrant colors. If you take, for example, Ultramarines, they were just a triadic relationship of primary colors. So it's very high contrast, very, you know, back in the day. But the style itself is obviously, as I said, it's changed over the years, and it's obviously refined and refined and refined over years. And it's really a way of presenting the models as best as possible and highlighting the models as best as possible The photos that are taken are for marketing purposes, to show off the model, to sell the model. So that style of highlighting everything and painting everything is so that obviously you can see all the details and everything on the miniatures really, really well. As years have passed, obviously we're starting to see weathering and things come into consideration, obviously on models, subtle weathering, and also the highlighting process. We spoke about this in another episode as well, whereby earlier on the highlighting stage, they didn't used to do what's now known obviously as a chunky highlight and then progressive edge highlight tones up to the bright point. It was predominantly all just on the edge, if that makes sense. So there wasn't like a chunky stage, then a thinner stage on the edge of the miniatures. But pointing to the book behind me, which obviously is something that for me, you know, I've had that for quite a long time. An amazing book, which if you can find it, search for it on eBay. It's worth every penny you spend on it. It's
for the audio listeners, it's the Eavy Metal Masterclass book from 2000. And...
Ooh, I'm gonna have to grab it and have a look at the date.
Is it just one book?
2002.
There's the original. That's what should have been there. Is this just one book? Is this a series?
It's one book. Yeah, 2011. So,
2011. Yeah. I thought it was really old.
No, 2011. Nope, 2011.
Oh, so, it wasn't like a reprint or something?
No, as far as I'm aware, no. I think that was the only.
I thought it was like an old.
Games Workshop have done loads of painting books over the years. So they've done lots and lots of different painting books. That one is the Eavy Metal Masterclass book, but there are early iterations of Eavy Metal painting guides or painting books. That one was put together by several members of the team, obviously doing independent articles within that, and a lot of it was a collation of painting guides from White Dwarf. So there were several different, like for example, Daz's Sanguinor was in White Dwarf. That's obviously in there. There's a bad.
What color's the base rim on that?
Can we get a base rim check? Sanguinor's a brown base rim.
That is about brown base rim,
and I'd argue that's not a gaming model. That's more of a display yeah. model. Okay, Daz, even I'm starting to get a bit confused now.
I would say if it probably...
That's probably just a GW thing,
As a work model, yeah. I don't think he maybe gets as much license on the base rim colour there.
Yeah.
I think also just as like a few like maybe key pointers or things to take into consideration for someone, that, again, who's new and maybe doesn't understand fully. I suppose the key takeaway of what makes something the Eavy Metal style is... the almost the unrealistic lighting and the edge highlighting everything, I guess, is the key thing when you look at one model to another.
Yeah, yeah.
When someone's referring to like the Eavy Metal style, probably they're referring to it's like fully edge highlighted, like every panel, every hard edge on the model.
So associated with like a very like clean finish as
very
well.
Very clean finish. Yeah. Extremely refined.
I would actually say as well, it's still, even though not necessarily the case anymore, probably still associated with bright colors. I think yes and no. I think people, when they say, like, if you saw something with brighter colors, you'd be inclined to be like, oh, it looks so heavy metal. Do you know what I mean? Like,
if you hear grim dark, you don't think box art, do you?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's kind of more we spoke about this, but it's not really like a refinement kind of thing.
I'm just saying, in terms of what people perceive it as and when they're using that terminology, I think a lot of people will use it when they're looking at bright colors. They'll say, oh, that's particularly heavy metal.
You could break it down and like digest it all, but like, if you're, people would speak about it more casually and more flippantly, like that's the sort of general connotation.
I think that'd be the main things, is the everything's edge highlighted. There's some bright colors. It's fairly clean.
It's probably, really clean.
And it's very clean. Yeah. I think that's a good synopsis.
So, main topic for this week, something we've spoken about quite a lot on previous episodes, more anecdotally through other topics. And I thought it'd be good to actually like have a proper crack at this as a full conversation, because I think motivation is something that people talk about a lot in the hobby. And it varies for people like wildly, depending on like what you're looking to get out of it, which we've spoken about before, like what you're doing it for, if you're doing it for like display or gaming or whatever. And I think it's one of those things that sort of changes a lot like throughout your life. Like you might find there's one period where you're like really, really mega motivated to paint, then you take a bit of a dip, and then you like sort of feel like you're supposed to get back into it because you don't like feel like you're just hanging up the brushes and you're not painting anymore. So I thought we'd just speak about how people can find motivation. What are your tricks to stay motivated? Where are you at, like maybe currently mentally with the hobby, that sort of thing?
Yeah. Should we go first? James is probably one of the most like consistently motivated to paint people that I've ever met. So I feel like you're a good person.
I've noticed this in myself. I think that comes from the fact of you don't get to paint as much as you used to.
Yeah, definitely.
Which I've noticed personally, like the more time I have to paint and like how motivated I am to paint, like don't live on the same plane, if you get what I mean. Like I feel like we had the comment saying earlier about like they listen to this podcast like while they're at work and it gets them like all hyped up. It's because you're away from the brushes, right?
Yeah.
Like if I have, when I was commission painting full time and I was painting like 10 hours a day, like pretty much every day, I would say that I didn't like struggle with motivation. Like people talk about like fatigue and like burnout and that sort of thing. I didn't have any of that, but I wouldn't say that I was like, oh, I'm like super motivated in the same way that I am now necessarily, because now I'm, you know, in the studio doing media. And I'm not painting, but I'm like around Warhammer in the same way that people like might listen to this podcast, right? Like you've kind of got it in the background, but you're not actually doing the thing you like. So that's when I found that I've been most motivated, is when I'm like not actually doing it.
Yeah.
So I would argue that maybe that's where...
Is that where your motivation comes from then?
Like the amount of time I've had to have to paint has diminished so massively over the last 4-5 years because of all the stuff I do on a day-to-day basis within Siege. And obviously when I first started Siege, obviously I was painting a lot. I was exactly the same as George when it was just me, obviously starting the company 10 years ago. I was painting all the time. And I think in that realm space, I kind of want to break it down into different segments, if that's all right, because it's like it's changed as it's gone on, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So like when I started, I was painting like you, 10, 12 hours a day, whatever, blah, blah. And I was like, I could be back in recruitment doing 500 phone calls a day to clients and candidates or whatever, blah, blah, blah. But I'm sitting here painting models for 10 hours a day. Like I've like won, you know, that kind of like was the reason why like I didn't burn out at all while I was commission painting. And then as obviously the company got bigger and as my availability or time availability diminished because of obviously the commitment to doing the other side of the fence, like the interest and passion just grew more because I was like, stuff would be coming in or stuff would be painted. I'd look at it and go, wow, that's amazing. I've not seen someone paint something like that before, that technique before. I want to try that. Oh, I haven't got the time to do it. And then when I got an hour to do it, I was then fired up to then do that, if that makes sense. So that kind of was for the middle part. And then now it's like, this is why I do fight so hard when like a model comes in. And like, I know obviously on the ops side, you handle obviously the allocation of bits and bobs to team and stuff. But like when something comes in and I'm like, I want to paint that, it's because I'm like ravenous to paint and like
ravenous.
And like it literally is like that. And it's
can
like,
you get any more motivated than describing yourself as ravenous for something? Pretty motivated.
The craziest part is that you've seen him when he's like, this is an accurate description.
Oh, it's spot on.
Yeah, I am. Because the thing is, it's like I have got obviously the commitment of the things I do on a daily basis and a very busy workload and you know that kind of stuff, plus also outside of work. You know, outside of the office, I've got two dogs that take up a lot of my time. You know,
that's like, one thing I was going to say is that like, because you mentioned it obviously has changed over the last like 4 or 5 years.
Yeah,
or whatever,
it has hugely.
But
yeah.
Like, that's not just business wise. Like you're, I think anyone anyone's life can sort of change over four or five years. And yours has had sort of that as well, because you've now got obviously other commitments and things that you didn't have to worry about 4 or 5 years ago as well.
Yeah, no, exactly.
We're outside of the company.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I could definitely see why. I wonder if there is like a correlation between people that struggle for motivation. Are they people that potentially actually do have a lot of time to paint? Because is motivation more easily found in people where their time's been restricted?
I bet that's a bit of a bell curve as well, because I bet if you go too far the other way, we have like barely any time to paint and you feel like then you've got to like get the most out of it, and you've got all this pressure to like, oh, I've only got like 30 minutes to paint this week, but I'm not really feeling it, but I feel like I'm sort of supposed to do it.
I have to, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe, yeah. I'm just, yeah, maybe there's some middle ground where like you have like the pinnacle of, in terms of just getting the most motivation out of it as possible. And I think obviously, yeah, with our situation, we have the double-edged sword of we're also surrounded by amazing models every day.
Well, this is the thing, like, you know, like, you know, something comes in.
Which isn't going to be an extremely relatable like thing. Not everyone's going to be able to be surrounded by models all the time.
But I think surrounding yourself by the hobby in other ways though, like listening to podcasts or watching tutorials.
Yeah, 100%. Like, so what I was going to say was like, I go in and out in terms of motivation and things. And I think, again, it's a difficult thing to talk about generally because everyone's experience with it is so unique. And I think part of the reason I struggle with the motivation sometimes is where my job is surrounded by it. Even just thinking about painting the models and stuff all day means I might get home and I don't want to think about it anymore. Or the opposite of that is I am thinking about it and looking at all these models all day and I can't wait to get home and paint. It's like a bit of a 50-50 like weird situation.
That's why I wanted to bring it up as well, because I feel like it's, like I said, like it's so different for everyone and it's so different like even on like a daily basis for everyone.
Yeah,
I don't feel like you should, I hate that people shame themselves so much for like not having motivation or being in a bit of a rut or a bit of burnout. Like I feel like it's so natural with any hobby. It's not specific to just the miniature paint stuff. And the thing I always say is those paints, those models will still be there for you, even if you take 2 weeks off, even if you take a month off, even if you take 6 months off, even if you don't pick up a model again until next year.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think that you're like guilty of a crime because you're not doing it.
I don't know if I've even necessarily spoken about it too much on the podcast, but I've spoken a lot about how, so I started going to the gym last year. And training in the gym and sort of painting, there's a lot of like
correlation
in terms of discipline and learning curves and behavioral patterns and motivation and things like that. And literally what you've just said, so I've obviously just been ill. I haven't been on the podcast last week or whatever. I haven't been in the gym for a week and a half. And my PT, like initially you'd think that they'd be a bit like, I still got to get in and still got to do it, whatever. But the reaction is instead more just, rather than like feeling bad on yourself for not going, it's like, well, gym's not going anywhere. Yeah. Like you're not ready for it at the moment. You're ill.
And are you in the best position or best frame of mind?
You're not
going to
do your best work.
You know?
You're going to make yourself worse probably. So the gym's not going anywhere. You can come back in a week or whatever.
And it's the same with painting, right? Because if you're ill when you go to the gym, and you're just going to make yourself like more ill, right?
Exactly,
so if you're not enjoying painting and you're just like painting for the sake of it, it's going to make you hate it even more.
It's going to make you dislike your painting. You're not going to do your best work. Mm-hmm. And again, same point, your models aren't going anywhere. Your paints aren't going anywhere. Like when you are motivated, it'll be, I think it's kind of difficult to come into a conversation about motivation and one of the bits of advice be, if you're not motivated, just don't paint. but that's true. You need to be okay with allowing yourself to be not motivated sometimes.
The lines are blurred for us because it is like our job. But if we think about it in the sense of a hobby, like it is for 99.9% of people, like the point of a hobby is to bring you enjoyment. So if you're not enjoying it, like it's not bringing you any value.
True. Yeah.
But there's loads of little bits and bobs which like, for example, like for me, if there's a stressful day or like that, painting is like the best cure to that because it lowers my heart rate, slows my breathing down, makes me concentrate on something that I'm enjoying. So there are things that it helps with massively for me. So the motivation to paint isn't it, motivation to paint isn't always as a result of physically wanting to paint something. It could be a case of I really want to paint just to relax or to calm.
I need
a break from something.
Do you know what? I for so long did not associate painting with relaxing.
It is, yeah.
And like, I think it's because I was just like stressed at like not being good or feeling under pressure for like, I spoke before on here about like feeling the pressure of being not a great painter, but coming into this job and blah, blah, blah. So I think I didn't associate it with being relaxing that much. And it actually is like a great way to kind of like wind down.
It's the best.
Relaxation thing. At the
if
end
you're going
of the
with an appropriate mindset of I'm doing this to relax, you will find it relaxing. If you're going it with the mindset of, oh God, I need to like paint because I've got this like game next week, or oh God, I need to paint because I haven't painted anything in 2 weeks.
Or I've got to enter something next tomorrow morning to Golden Demon and I've got to paint in a hotel room.
Yeah, yeah, that's tomorrow. Not
That's where the stress comes from.
I think that's probably, I always viewed it, I never even thought about it as a relaxation thing. And then I remember once, quite a while ago, I don't think I've even mentioned this to him or whatever, but Quipster posted like a story where he said something about like, I was just doing like my like 1 hour painting, like relaxation before bed kind of thing. And I was like, oh yeah, that is, it should be a relaxing thing. And it can be a relaxing thing. And I'm in the habit of like, you know, no screens for like an hour before bed or something like that. Like I can't be like looking at my phone and things. So that's a perfect way to do that. I'm not going to be looking at a screen if I'm painting for an hour, you know what I mean? As long as I haven't got like Netflix on or something.
That ties into that comment from earlier, because someone said about like listening to the podcast as their like little hobby session. Mm. I really like that as like a digestible like amount of time.
Mm.
So I think that's a good idea doing that in the same sort of thing like you just said. Like if you're looking for like some sort of thing to keep you going, like to keep spurring you on, like maybe set a more digestible amount of time rather than being like, I need to paint to get this to completion. But like, I'm going to paint for this amount of time and whatever gets done, gets done. That's where the like relaxing bit comes in for me. Cause it's like, oh, I've got an hour this evening to paint. It's not, oh, I need to get this model done and I'm going to sit here until it's done and be miserable.
But part of the thing that I always say is that like when you sit down at your desk to paint in a session, a lot of people will just pick up the brush and quickly start, grab the last thing they're painting and carry on with it or whatever. But I genuinely think spending like 5-10 seconds just thinking like, so what do I want to achieve this session? I think that helps massively with motivation, because it's like, if you sit down and the first thing you do is pick up something just because you want to get it done, you need that dopamine fix of I've achieved something or managed to do something within the session or whatever, then that you should really take a step back and be like, right, okay, I have 30 minutes to paint. What am I going to use this 30 minutes for? And is it going to benefit me as a painter moving forward? Or am I just going to use it to relax? Or am I going to use it to try and try a new technique or try something or test a cut? I bought a couple of new colors at the weekend. I haven't had to put them on the palette yet, so I don't know what they're like. I think assessing the session that you're having is very, very important. I think if you don't do that, I think what happens is that you can almost feel like you've got to achieve something in that session. There's got to be some tangible thing within that session to warrant you sitting down and doing it. I think it does sometimes lead to putting way too much pressure on achievement within a designated period of time. So if you do literally the first thing you do when you sit down and go, right, I've got half hour to paint. Okay, cool. Well, if I do this model, I'm going to rush it. Okay. Or I might want to get all the leather on it, but there's no way I can get the leather on it in 30 minutes. So then I'm going to have to rush it or space it over a couple of sessions. Or you can go, right, well, I've only got 30 minutes. So maybe in this 30 minutes, just cleaning all my brushes for this week to make sure they're all as best as possible. And I use that half an hour so that my brushes are all clean. I can come back to my desk the next 3-4 hour session. And I know that all my tools and all my brushes are put away nicely or cleaned, or you have a half hour clean session at your desk. You can still stick a podcast on and listen to it. I put, you know, when I do a big clean at the end of a project, whatever, on my desk, I'll stick an audio book on, or I'll stick, you know, one of Luton's videos, giving him a plug or whatever, but I'll stick something on that allows me to then just still listen to something, enjoy what I'm doing. And then at the end of that, I've actually got a springboard for the next time I sit down, because it's all put away properly. You'll be in ecstasy, you know, like it's just like it, you know. I think assessment of investment of time is really important, and like being able to choose whether you know you're using it for your betterment, as in are you going to try a technique or are you going to do something, or are you just going to literally clean everything, put all your paints away, make sure, you know, I'm going to tell you this now, something that I do all the time when I don't have massive time investment, okay, as in if I don't have 2 hours to paint or whatever, the thing that absolutely drives me nuts is obviously paint's drying out. I can't stand it. So I will literally spend, if I only got half hour, I'll literally get a pair of tweezers and I'll look at any of my paint pots.
Clean all the pots.
And get all the crap out the lids.
It's really quite satisfying.
That sounds like the best day. It's so satisfying. I'm not even going to lie. Because like the thing is, you end up with all this crap taken out of your paint pots. They're all sealed perfectly. And also at the same time, while you're taking them off the shelf and doing, you can then organize at the same time. So you're being efficient with the time and you're making your desk better for when you come back to it the next time you paint. Half hour well spent. I've chilled out. It's not a task that you're overly concentrating on massively. So if you had a stressful day or if you had, it's really good to just get that done. Then you can actually go away with some sense of achievement. Because it's
I think that's an important thing to touch on as well, is I would say there's a couple of things. I think kind of accepting the like small victories is a good way to.
You've got to give yourself some cheap wins.
To stay motivated. So doing that and like setting the goal for this session that's easily achievable and then achieving it, like there's absolutely nothing wrong with that at all. And you'll feel good for it.
You get that dopamine hit. You go to bed at the end of that session. Yeah. If you do it, like, you know, if you've got like an hour to paint every evening or a half hour, whatever, you literally go to bed thinking, oh, tomorrow I'll come back and my paints are sealed properly.
Shout out to everyone painting at 6 a.m.
Or whenever you paint, like, you know, but again, doing that is massively beneficial for those small wins that you're saying. It really helps with it. It's a great little task.
Yeah. I think one of the things I would say as well is that one of the things that's helped me a lot, just in general as well, this isn't even necessarily to do with painting, but it has helped transferring it to painting, is understanding like the difference between needing to be like inspired and needing to be motivated. I think there's two different things, and they get lumped together sometimes. But I feel like if I was in need of inspiration, if you're in need of inspiration for painting, you're probably already motivated to paint. You want to paint, and you just need a bit of a push in the right direction, maybe, or something like that. And I think we talk a lot about being inspired by looking at great models and a great bit of artwork and things like that. I don't necessarily think that would help me. If I was completely unmotivated to paint or I was struggling to fit painting in, I don't know if that alone would quite push me.
I never thought of it that way, actually. That's a really good point.
But needing motivation is something a little bit different. And I think the motivation for me, I've noticed, it's going to make me sound a little bit of a selfish person, I think, but it only really comes when you can find some kind of benefit to yourself in the end goal, and you only get that by setting goals. So in terms of like painting, I'm only really going to be motivated to paint if there's something I'm trying to reach at the end of it, and that can be as much as I'm trying to have fun painting, like I've gone on about before. Like that's enough. If you feel like you're going to get something out of it and that thing is a priority to you, you won't struggle with motivation at all.
That ties into what I've said before on the podcast before of what do you want out of the hobby? Should be something, a conversation that you should probably have with yourself if you're like suffering from this. Because if you're looking to get out of it, like I just want to play games with my friends, then I would say maybe set yourself some easier goals of painting, something more achievable, like a cheap win, like we said. But if you're just looking to get enjoyment out of it, I would say like, don't worry about the outcome. Just worry about enjoying your time doing it. Mm. Like you're doing the thing, that's the enjoyment.
We always say like experimentation is one of the things which it should be enjoyable as part of doing this. And like that's whether it's mixing colors, whether it's coming up with a new recipe, whether it's, you know, trying a new thing model that you've liked the look of and you try to emulate it, or a paint scheme or whatever, or trying to copy. Like that should be part of it. That's another thing that should spur you on to give you that motivation to do well, and also inspire you to, oh wow, look, I've achieved this, I've done that. I think, yeah, you know.
Ultimately, I think I've just realized that with regards to motivation, there'll be times where I'm not that motivated to paint. There'll be times where I'm really motivated to paint. And the times where I am motivated is because there is something that I want out of it. Mm-hmm. And yeah, whether that is I'm going to enjoy it in this moment and that's what I feel like doing, or I'm moving towards a certain goal, or I've always wanted this particular model painted on my shelf, so I really want that on my shelf. If you have a model that you really want to paint, you're going to be motivated to paint. Like it's one of those things where there's no like quick hack to be more motivated. Like you will be motivated when there's something that you want at the other end, I guess, kind of thing.
Yeah.
So like measurable results are quite important, like to just have it yourself. Like if you, like I said, if you just want to be like, oh, I just want to paint this evening for, you know, 35 minutes and just do it to relax. Like if you set that as a goal, at the end of that, you'll feel accomplished. Whereas if you'd gone in like kind of aimlessly without a goal, even if you'd done the exact same thing, that mindset of what you do going into it is really important to how you'll feel at the end of it. Mm. If you sat down to paint and all you got done was like painted some belt pouches, and you went into that session like, oh, I'm going to paint tonight. You might finish that being like, oh, all I got done was the belt pouches. But if you went into that session thinking, oh, I've got 35 minutes to paint tonight. Oh, I'm really looking forward to it. I'm just going to sit down and enjoy myself. And at the end of it, if you'd done that exact same thing, all you've done is just painted the belt pouches, you'd be like, oh, that was nice. I enjoyed myself.
Yeah,
you'd
feel accomplished. That was my goal. Yeah,
but you've still done the exact same thing.
Yeah.
Like the outcome is the same. Yeah, how you feel about it is completely different.
Yeah. Yeah. I just think it's a really interesting thing. I think the whole motivation thing is just such a... interesting thing to tackle, because it's like I say, half of it is just being okay with the fact that you're not going to be motivated sometimes, like not coming down on yourself for it.
I like what you said as well about like separating it from inspiration, because that's something that I've probably misconstrued in my head as like lack of inspiration, thinking that was like lack of motivation.
I think if you're separate things,
if you're conflated though, like I guess that's why it relates
people,
to what you
people
said.
Definitely use them interchangeably, but I think if you're in need of inspiration and you're aware that you're in need of inspiration, then you're clearly motivated to paint already.
But I think that relates to what you said about like, oh, you're around models all day and sometimes when you get home, you don't feel like painting. Like you might be around models all day and you're inspired.
Yeah, they're very inspirational.
But that doesn't necessarily mean that you're motivated.
Doesn't actually motivate me. Yeah, it's two different things almost. Because it does get used. People kind of chop and change it. And I think, we've done whole episodes on like inspirational things in painting and stuff like that. And not everything that we spoke about in those are necessarily things that would get me out of a painting block or something. Yeah. They're cool and they help, but definitely two different things to look at.
I think when you have, like, especially in my situation, I think when you don't have as much time to paint and you love painting, that time that you do get to paint becomes way more, well, I've got to get something done in this, or I've got to have some kind of result or something, whatever.
Yeah. So does the pressure go up?
But I think pressure increasing makes you perform better. I think our adversity.
I think that's an individual thing.
Potentially, yeah.
You're also painting at like the display competition level,
which
is a bit of a different thing.
Not always. Like my Castchan army, is it? Like that's painted to a decent gaming standard. On each model, there's a physical stop point where
But did you enjoy painting that Catachan army?
Yes and no.
The outside looking in, I would think that you enjoyed building it and the concept of it and everything. Yeah. But then when it came down to actually having to slog through painting it and not painting to a higher level and things like that, it felt like you didn't actually enjoy the having to rush.
I think that's something that people are definitely going to relate to, because I think that is the root cause of why people have these massive piles of grey shame. Mm. It's because it's so easy to have an idea and it's so easy to buy a load of models and it's so easy to like have this romantic like view of like having this finished thing at the end, but you skip the bit where you've got to do it all and you realize you don't actually want to do it all. You just want to have the thing.
The end result, it's that Amazon effect.
But then how bad you want that thing at the end is what will lead you to be motivated, because you know James finished the army. He wanted the army.
So I had a tournament that I had to go to, plus also I'd always wanted a Catachan army from when I was I'd never had one when I was younger, when the codex was out. So those two things kind of gave me a goal to aim for. But you're quite right, like I love the creation aspect of it, like the building it, doing all the conversions, all the little bits and bobs and things like that, like the narrative side of it, all the character names, like the backstory, all that kind of stuff. I love all of that. And then when you're sitting there with 128 bodies to paint, it's like...
Because, I mean, I was coming into work every day and like the first thing was like, oh, I painted like 100 faces last night or whatever. Like it was just like constant. Like when you actually came to like the grassroots, like the... getting the job done, the sluggy bits, like the slog, it like it seemed like it wasn't a very fun time.
That's why, like, one of the my proudest hobby achievements is the fact of, like, don't get me wrong, I have like a handful of models that I've not painted and stuff that's been sat in the box and whatever, but I've never had that massive pile of like gray plastic shame that everyone talks about, purely because I know that I would do that exact same thing of like, whenever I like look at buying stuff, I think about the, would I enjoy painting it? Would I enjoy like doing the thing?
Yeah.
Or do I just want the thing? Yeah. Right? Like I trip myself up and I won't make this mistake again. I really, really wanted a box art quality Sons of Horus army when the Horus Heresy dropped. Yeah. And I realized very, very quickly, I didn't actually want to do it. I wanted to have it,
yeah.
Which is why I bought the army box and I've done what a lot of people do. Like started painting them and then lost all motivation for it.
I suppose, and I mean, sat on the shelf. That is also why Siege exists, I suppose.
Yeah,
we probably have a lot of clients that have that exact same.
But now I've learned from that and I go like, I think about the doing of the project, right? Like
think about that first.
Yeah, that's why like I only buy models for myself that I really want to paint. Yeah. Not necessarily that I like want to, like this is why I've never got into armies.
When
like,
you're going to enjoy the process.
But yeah, partly because I haven't, like I don't do the games. I just like the display stuff. But like when I'm done with a model, generally speaking, like I put it in my cabinet, but I don't really look at it. Like the enjoyment part for me in the hobby is the painting.
Yeah.
Well, this is what I was saying to you, like on a couple of episodes, I think you've missed this a little bit, Joe, obviously since you've been infected by Nurgle, but like I've had an ad mech itch for quite some time.
Oh, I did hear this. Yeah,
I've had an ad mech itch for quite some time. And
You actually spoke to me about this after you'd recorded the episode that you mentioned it on, I think.
Yeah, like I'm literally, it's been there quite a while and it's the first time in a long time where I've been like, I actually want to do something pretty significant.
I said, we got the stilts, boy.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
I said to him on that episode, I said, do one model and
get
see
it,
if that scratches the
itch.
Because at the end of that, you'll have one of two things. You'll either realize you don't, like, you'll like scratch the itch and you're kind of done with it. Or you'll have a model that you can add to your army when it's done.
I mean,
there's no loss.
I had a towel itch, and that has been well and truly scratched.
Yeah,
I'm telling you now.
No, I agree. I understand totally. But I am very much looking at AdMech and going, I want to do some stuff with this because I just got loads of ideas and stuff. And I think it is a combination of the inspiration, but because also as well, I am always motivated to paint because of not having loads of the time to paint. It's given me something to go, right, well, I want to start with maybe a combat patrol and just paint it in the scheme that I've wanted to paint.
I literally wouldn't even do that. I'd literally do one model.
Yeah, I've just got this itch to paint.
That's not how James works.
That's not how James works. That's my advice for everyone though. Like if you're listening, like if you're thinking about doing an army project, buy like a character, like maybe not a centerpiece, but like one of the like upper level characters.
Yeah, like,
paint that, do that to completion. And at the end of it, you'll have one of two things. You'll have scratched the itch, or you'll be hella motivated to actually do the army, and you won't have lost anything because you can add that model to the army if you want to do it. And if you don't want to buy the army and go down that route,
yeah.
You still had like a nice little project that's wrapped up and you've got a cool model to show for it.
Yeah. I've got a model to scratch the itch, but I think it's not going to fulfill the itch.
Let's talk again when you're done.
Yeah.
In 6 months when you finally finish painting it.
Yeah, I mean, bit of a tangent, but yeah, it's all motivation talk.
Yeah,
it's like, yeah, it's a bit of a difficult topic. Really.
I do think, I always say this on like classes and stuff. I do 100% think that mindset is just as important as like the skill behind the brush and developing the skill and the ability and all that, like crafting and building your mindset to. So that you know, right, okay, what this session is for and like, you know, how best way I can apply myself in the session, what am I going to use it for? You know, have I got X amount of time to paint or X amount of time to paint? I think the mindset and the thought process are two things which kind of go hand in hand with even like just color selection, learning a little bit of color theory and all those things we talk about. But like those two, mindset will help with motivation because you'll go, right, okay, well, I've got this time to paint, so I'm going to do this, so I'm going to do this, so I'm going to do this. That will help hugely motivate you. So then you, when you do get that longer amount of time, you're ready for it, you know, and you're ready and you've really thought, right, well, in this time frame, I'm going to do this because I won't get it done in this. And I think that helps hugely with motivation, like just thinking about it, assessing stuff. That will help you massively, the mindset of approach. So yeah.
If you're enjoying this episode of Paint Perspective, I just wanted to ask that you do us a huge favor by leaving a rating and review on whatever platform you're using and also choosing to follow and subscribe. It'd really help us out and it helps us deliver these episodes to you for free every week. Now back to the show.
Question of the week time. Thank you everyone for submitting your questions for Question of the Week. If you have a question that you'd like us to answer on the show, please leave it in the comments on YouTube, or if you are listening on an audio platform of your choice, please go over to the Siege Studios Instagram and fire us over a DM or answer our poll that we do on our story. Question this week comes from Psycho Minis, who says, if you could have GW make one specific model from the lore, what would it be and why?
Ooh.
I had to think on this. I've got one for this. It's technically been done, but I won't count it for what will become obvious reasons.
Okay.
I really, really want a plastic, like proper, dedicated Garville Loken.
Right.
From the Heresy. Because I absolutely fell in love with like the original like quadrilogy of four books from the Horus Heresy novels. And Loken was always my favourite character.
Yeah.
And the only model they've ever done for him was the jewel piece of him and Abaddon, the Forge World model.
Yeah.
One, that model's like kind of old. And two, it's like this jewel diorama thing. Yeah, I want just like a proper character model. Mark IV Heresy armour, plastic, the new upscaled size as well.
Mm-hmm.
If when the new...
I thought you were going to say, if anyone at GW is listening, just please.
No, I was going to say like, they've said that they're doing like, you know, they've done the new Mark III kit. Mm-hmm. They're doing like a Mark IV kit, right? Didn't they show CAD files for that or something?
I don't know.
I can't remember.
I don't know if they're redoing it. I mean, Maximus pattern armor is my favorite. So
either way, if/when they do proper Mark IV new plastic kit, I'll 100% get a custom service model from Siege for that model. Like if GW never make it, because I absolutely desperately want one of those and I really want to paint one.
Yeah. Me? Or do you want to get?
I've got one. Yeah. If you want me to do it.
Yeah. Go on.
So,
it's like cheat codes for James because he's got so many CS models made for him.
He's literally already had any answers to his question he could probably have. He's already had
James
it.
James is thinking what have I not had sculpted for me yet?
I've got one. So contrary to the normal trend from me, I'm going to go left field.
Right, left
field. Yeah.
Going to go right of left field.
Right of left field.
It's not a Blood Angel Joe. It's Genesis chapter.
It's not Genesis chapter.
I'm thinking maybe based on our earlier conversation, it's going to be a catch up.
Well, along those lines, but not. Okay. So I really like all the Cypher's Cane books. Do you know where Cypher's Cane
is? I'm not aware of what that is.
Cypher's Cane is a commissar. He's an Imperial Guard commissar. But he has he's like the funniest, he's like he just has loads of scenarios and situations that happen to him which are like completely, he's like, you know, orcs are like funny in 40k.
Mm-hmm.
He's like the funny Imperial Guard kind of character.
He's the Mr. Bean of the Imperial Guard.
You said it, that is exactly it. So see, he has loads of funny things that happen to him.
And that's another fairly old reference for you. So you've done Mr. Bean and what did you know earlier?
Have
that
you been
I didn't
scrolling
know
up
I was Inspector Clouseau as a Pink Panther.
Yeah.
You've been,
who
been,
are you?
I would actually like a Cypher's Cane commissar model. That'd be really funny because it'd be a cool model. A commissar is a really awesome sort of character for guard. But also you could do some quite nifty rules and things with him to emulate some of the luck and stuff and just things that happened to him, basically. I don't want to spoil it for anyone, but if you've read the Cypher's Cane books or if you know of Cypher's Cane, then you know all the things I'm talking about. I'd like to have that as a model. I think it'd be really cool. Something a bit different. I think there's loads of awesome commissar models out there. Old metal ones and new plastic Officio Perfectus models, etc. But yeah.
I think, is it going to be in like an action pose, like tripping over a tactical
rock? It's got to be like, yeah, something funny. Yeah, it would be great.
Slipping on a banana skin.
And shooting at the same time.
Tactical banana skin.
Yeah, no, something like that. But yeah, no, I think Cypher's Cane as a character would be amazing. And then you could do some really funny rules. Do it as like a limited edition model, like one of those anniversary ones or something that.
Commemorative, or something like that.
Like that. Yeah, that's what I would go with. And it would have very minimal red on it. So there you go.
Mine would have a fair bit of red on it, actually. I had...
Genesis chapter?
I mentioned in the looting episode about the Marines Exemplar.
Yes. Yeah.
And their whole core kind of story being that their chapter master has a Thunderhawk gunship that he has. And that was sort of crashed in on a jungle world. And they don't know whether he's like dead or alive. He's like behind enemy lines, whatever. Their whole kind of mission is to go and find him.
Space Marine chapters have a real fiction for a leader that's lost.
Yeah, yeah. I think it would be cool if we saw some more character-specific vehicles. So like
that's a shout.
We maybe spoke not too long ago when we were getting some White Dwarves ready for the set. I think we maybe spoke to Adam, and it was it like a Marnius Kalgar Land Raider
conversion.
And I was like, it was like the old conversion of Marnius Land Raider. And yeah, I thought it'd be, I would, these characters that have vehicles associated with them, I think it would be really cool to get one. So I would like a Thunderhawk gunship that is specific to their chapter master and has some of the Helldrake. That one will never happen because I don't think they're going to mention
it. Thunderhawk is the issue with that.
I don't think they're going to mention this chapter again ever, probably. But
you've got two issues there. It's a Thunderhawk gunship and it's a chapter that no one's heard of.
Yeah, exactly. So,
and the plastic Thunderhawk is a thing that gets thrown around and people have joked around for many, many years. But
in general, I think, yeah, some kind of character... specific character-based vehicles. Or maybe the listeners have a few comments I can drop on what suggestions on what that would be.
Have they done any specific character vehicles that weren't Dreadnoughts?
Yes, Yarrick's Baneblade. Fortress of Redemption. Yarrick's got a personal Baneblade.
Right.
Yeah, so they've done characters on... So they did like Samael... on on his thing.
On his jet bike.
Which was different. It's a unique thing to anything else on any other model.
Other than Dreadnoughts and Samael and Yarrick's tank, I can't think of...
It's mostly just like Space Marine Dreadnoughts, right?
It's mostly Dreads, like Bjorn and and Moria.
And then the upgrade kits for vehicles are more generic, aren't they? They aren't like character specific.
No.
I think it would be cool, to get some character specific vehicles.
Yeah, I think I've got to throw it in there as a funny one, and it is another guard one, but I think they should make that tank commander with a sword from the Lehman Russ, where it's like, drive me closer.
Oh, he's like standing on top of it.
My sword, yeah. I think they should make the tank commander. Yeah.
Hobby hack. This is our closing little segment where we share a hobby hack with you that hopefully you can implement into your painting. These are like little quick tips. James, I think you have one for us this week.
So I'm not big on fishing.
Fishing. Like carp.
Yeah. You'll get the point.
Catfish.
Yeah, you'll get the point. If you do fish and you're watching this, I'm never so sorry. I'm not slating fishing. I'm just saying it is a comparison to what I'm going to talk about. Transfers. So I often see a lot of people do transfers and you have your bowl of water and you put your transfer in the bowl of water and it floats around.
I used to do it in an upside down base. I would like fill up the base with a little bit of water and put it in there. Yeah.
And then the paper, the transfer comes off the paper.
Do you know what I done? I'm just going to throw this in because I think it's funny. You know those like goo dessert pots that everyone has like 400 of in their cabinet? I always used to use those for transfers.
Yeah.
It's the one thing I ever found a use for them for.
That's not the hobby hack. Yeah. But whether you use any kind of solution or if you use Microsol, Microset, etc., adding a third party chemical or thing into the mix doesn't normally have good results at the end of the process, if that makes sense. You get like lifting, bubbles, warping of the transfer, things like that. So not putting water into your transfer as much as possible is basically what I'm alluding to. Having a transfer float in a bowl and spin around for ages and then separate.
And then get torn in half when your tweezers pick it out.
It's a nightmare to scoop it out.
You get your brush in there and you get it like perfectly on it and then it gets like clung to the side of the pot.
Yeah.
And then you like try to get it wet just and like, get it up again.
It just wraps around the brush. It's the slap wristband thing again. It just wraps around the brush.
You like, oh, I've thought ahead of this. I'm going to get like a pair of tweezers and then you like rip it in half. You've got to get a new one.
So, sack the bowl off. Just get yourself a bit of Blitz. Not sponsored. Hope we are.
Blitz, we know you listen every week.
Blitz,
We're waiting for your email.
We haven't bigged up Blitz in a while.
So, wet some paper towel, thoroughly wet it, and then just cut the transfers out and sit the backing paper on the wet paper towel, and it will absorb into the backing sheet without adding loads of water into the mix. And then all you've literally got to do is just touch the top of the transfer with your finger, see if it shifts and moves on the backing sheet. As soon as you notice that it's loose, the paper towel has done its job. You can then literally get some tweezers. What I tend to do is I shift the transfer off a little bit just so that it's kind of like leaves a bit of the backing paper, get my tweezers, pick it up. And then what I'll do is get a dry bit of Blitz and just literally between my thumb and my forefinger, just squeeze a little bit, not really hard, just squeeze a bit and take any moisture off and transfer it all.
I'm going to try it once and just rip, completely yeah. rip it.
As soon as you said that, you lost me, being yeah. honest. I'm like, we've added a whole step here. That's
you've got to add the step, because the thing is, you're trying to remove water from the mix, essentially. So then basically the transfer is, because all the water is doing, the whole reason is purely to release the transfer. The water does not, is not invited to the party. All right, okay. All right, so you literally...
The only upside of water is it doesn't, if you've got the surface that you're sticking the transfer to wet, it means you've got working time.
I find with the set though, for Microsoft, I find that it doesn't, you still get that working time. It doesn't.
Yeah, I was going to say, you do get a little bit.
You do get some working time with it.
No, but it's doing the same job. I'm saying if you don't use Microsoft, because they're not necessarily required, especially for a flat surface.
No, I agree. The only thing I would say is that by taking out as much water as possible, or all of it if you can, it's literally a case of then there's no sort of... third party involved in the chemical reaction.
I think in this example, you're using Microsoft.
Gotcha.
Yeah. I mean, personally, I
use them on everyone. Yeah, anyway,
I think the biggest thing from what you've said is stop dipping your transfers in water to let them separate. Just put them on a bit of paper towel.
After that,
if you've got your own method for transfers, like, more power to you. But like, that first step is like the big 99% of the hack for me.
The water is purely to remove the transfer from the backing sheet. That's it. It's that magical thing where it releases the transfer. That's all that matters, and that's all the water is used for. Like, I can't stand it when I've done it in the past and I've had a bowl and the transfer paper's fallen off and the transfer is like, you know, like one of those, what's one of those little bugs that sits on top of the water and skates, pond skate or whatever it is. It's like literally like one of those things just sitting on top of the water.
Why do transfers like inconsistently like sink or float as well?
Yeah, weird. They're just weird little things that we'll never understand. I think it's a complete lottery. I'm always like, okay, I need like one of these transfers. So I'll cut four of them off.
just use a damp bit of paper towel, sit the transfer on top of it. It'll absorb water through the backing sheet, transfer's loose, job done. Like, it's just so much easier. No fishing.
I find that like I can do other stuff because I've got like a minute for it to like absorb, right?
Yeah.
I'll be like, oh, I'm about to put the transfers on. So I'll cut out the transfers that I need. I'll put them on my damp piece of kitchen paper and then like, right, okay, I've got a minute to like get my surface ready, get my microsole, get my microsole out.
But that's,
by the time I'm done like prepping the surface, the transfer is like ready to go. Yeah. And it's just sat there on your paper towel, literally ready for you, rather than having like floating around in a bowl of water. And then you've finally gotten out of the water and now the microsole's dry on the model. So you've got to like reapply it to that. But I'm holding a transfer with this.
The other thing as well is that, think about it like from a focus perspective as well. You're not splitting your attention between the bowl, making sure it hasn't sunk or it's not released in the bowl and swimming around or whatever, blah blah. Your attention is a lot more strong. You're basically just focused on this specific thing. You know, you haven't got to look at the transfer. You know it's done its job and it's just sitting there waiting for you to be ready to use it, if that makes sense. So stop putting transfers in big bowls of water or whatever those things were that you said.
Stop a little ramekin.
Yeah, ramekin. So
stop fishing.
That's the hobby hack. Stop fishing. Yeah.
Well, a real concise hack there.
Yeah.
Right on brand for us. Yeah. Thank you everyone for listening to this week's episode of Paint Perspective. Little PSA, if you'd like to join the Siege Studios Discord, it is free. And we also have a patrons only section for our patrons. If you want to support the show as well, head over to patreon.com/Siege Studios. We have a new tier on there for podcast listeners as well. Thank you. We'll catch you next week.